praise God. That's really a help to our school, I know. I wanted her to share that because I want you to know that God takes being first very important. And when you put him first, just the act of putting him first. And I'm not trying to make a legalism out of it or anything like that. I just want you to know that God said, prove me. You proved it, and it just like boom, 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 like a whole domino effect. I want you to know that God desires you to be blessed. He desires you to be blessed. And that's why I've been teaching this series, and I'm continuing today. We've been kind of doing some intermittent teaching between some other activities and events on this series, which we're calling Money's Worth, because God wants you to get your money's worth, amen? And it comes out of your relationship with him. We're talking about biblical wisdom for personal prosperity, and we've been talking about that because the Bible talks a lot about it, and because it deals, it gets in us, it messes with us, it gets in our area that's sensitive to us, and we need to allow God in those sensitive areas. We need to let God move, and that was one testimony. I literally had, just in our staff meeting, we had three or four testimonies. I've had another several testimonies, just as people have begun to obey God and reset themselves in their giving, and it's blessing everything that they have. This is a spiritual law principle. I didn't say this. This isn't my teaching. This is the teaching of Jesus. This is the teaching in the Bible. And so that's important because God wants you to be free. He wants you to be free in every way. How many know you can do more in freedom than you can in bondage? Amen? I want to be free. If you want to be in bondage, you can. I want to be free. But the assignment that God has given to me in this series is to give you power to prosper. And I'm not in the stereotype version a prosperity preacher, but I definitely believe God wants his children to prosper. I don't want the opposite of that to be in my life. Amen? There's nowhere in the Bible that God wants his children to suffer. Now, how many know suffering can happen? We live in a broken world, and we can get hit, and we have a devil that hates us, and we can walk through all kinds of problems. But what we have is a God that will carry us through the problems. You've been given a divine ability from God to walk out your purpose and to have the things that you need inwardly and outwardly to walk out that purpose. But just because God gave you the divine ability, that doesn't make you prosper. It just means you have the potential to prosper. The Bible doesn't say that God gives you wealth. The Bible says he gives you power to get wealth. That means he gives you potential and opportunities and abilities that you have to develop in your life. Why? Because God wants to partner with you. It's what Pastor Steve Mayanja spoke to us last week about being a partner with Jesus. And we were able to be partners. Why? Could God just take care of something? God can speak and something exists. He's God. But God wants to partner with people. His whole method is that we would get to engage with him in how he works. And it's absolutely powerful. It's life-changing. It's amazing. And so today my heart is to get into this next dimension, what God has for you. And it's important that you hear. Listen, if you don't use it, you might lose it, right? Somebody else is going to take your opportunity and run with it. You need to take what God gives you, so don't get mad when somebody else takes what I'm teaching you and uses it while you're sitting back not doing anything. You have to apply the Word of God for the Word of God to work in your life. That's how it works, because faith without works is dead. The Bible says that. So today my heart is to get into you this next dimension, and the first thing that God says to man after he creates man is be fruitful. And I think that's really important for you to know. It's the first commandment God gives to him, and it reveals that God wants man to be blessed, right? You have to get this inside of you. Not only does God want you to be blessed, God wants you to be fruitful. And fruitfulness is a self-perpetuating, replicating blessing. God only said, let there be, and it was one time. And then in his creation, he put the propensity to self-reproduce, to be fruitful over and over. God has put inside of you the ability for you to be fruitful. That means he doesn't just bless you miraculously once in a while, but he has called you to live in a life that is fruitful and blessing according to your purpose. And that's important. Why is that important for me to know? Because you have a spiritual right in connection with your faith to expect the blessing of God to operate in your life. And many times we receive the principles of God's blessing, but we do it in a sense of fear. We have this fear, well, if I misstep or make a wrong decision, I'm going to sabotage the blessings of God in my life. So I live in this subconscious fear of never attaining what I believe God has given to me. Listen, I want to tell you something amazing about God. God can even bless you when you don't deserve to be blessed. He can even bless me when I make a mistake, when I don't do things right. But here's the thing, if you want to live in the continual fruitfulness, you have to apply the spiritual principles from God's word to your life so that you can go somewhere that you've never been, so that you can arrive at the place that God has called you to arrive in. And most of the time, this fear that gets inside of us comes because we have not accepted a spirit of blessing. Now listen, there's a spirit of blessing, and that spirit of blessing exists in God's nature. We're looking at blessing as something God does for us, whereas blessing is actually something God is. It's who he is. It's in his nature. So you can receive provision and your life be an up and down roller coaster and still not grasp the spirit of the provider. When God blesses you, he blesses you for your relationship with him to grow stronger. When God brings provision, he brings provision so that you can know the provider. And God will cause you to live in perpetual provision as long as you understand this is about God. This is about my relationship with him. As soon as I start to put more emphasis on the blessing than the blesser, now I bring myself out of blessing. You see? And it's important. So I want to talk about the full provision of the creative processes of the Spirit. And God has put this earth, he's put the things around me here for me to explore and enjoy. There is blessing, there is opportunities all around you every day for you to take a hold of. You have to recognize that God's provision is all around you. It's everywhere. You have to see it and take advantage of it. So if you have your Bibles, I want you to go ahead and turn to the epistle of 3 John. 3 John, it's just one chapter. If you go to the very back of your Bible and turn back about two books, you're going to find it. It's about one page long, but it's a powerful book, 3 John. But I want you to know that blessing comes through that relationship, your relationship with God. And from that relationship, there's a release on the inside of you that causes you to succeed over adversity. Listen, to be blessed means that you succeed over adversity. It doesn't mean that you don't have adversity. Some people think when you get blessed, you don't have problems anymore. No, you can have adversity and you can still succeed over adversity because of your blessing. You see, God will take you through something, over something. He'll get you to the other side of it. Sometimes you don't understand it when you're in the middle of it. You feel like you're under pressure. But if you will keep walking that journey to the purpose that God has predestined for you, you will one day turn and look back and say, I see God. If you're walking this out, and that's how blessing works. And I'll tell you as a living testimony, you can be blessed and have all kinds of problems. You can. You can have trouble on the right and the left and still be blessed. You can have trouble in your kids, your house, your life, your finances, and you can still find places where you're blessed, and God will take you through the things and use the very things that the enemy tries to kill you with, and he'll turn around and use those to kill the enemy and bless you. That's how God works. You just can't get caught up in the horizontal where your all focus is how blessed I am here or how unblessed I am here. You have to get your focus on the vertical. It's about your relationship with God. And you know you're blessed not because you don't have problems. You know you're blessed because the problems don't have you. That was good right there. Listen, you need to write that down. You know you're blessed not because your problems go away, but because the problems no longer have you. And so today I'm going to pull out these principles that are from God's word. They're going to work like keys to open doors for your personal blessing. I'm going to zoom out and I'm going to hit a couple of key things today. But I want you to look at 3 John chapter 1. It's only one chapter, verse 2. And John says these words, "Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things." Come on, shout all things. not some things. I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. And the key word in this verse is your soul, because God is after your soul. Now, prosperity, in the definition of a lot of wrong teaching, is just built around resources or stuff or bank accounts and cars. Listen, that's not really the major thing. That's not the important thing. I know sometimes it feels like it is. But prosperity in the Bible meaning, in the original meaning from the original language, means to successfully progress on a journey. That means that there is a destination that God has divinely assigned to you, and as long as you're moving forward toward that destination, that's what the Bible refers to as prosperity. That forward movement towards a destination. There has to be a forward motion in our lives, a forward motion towards your divine purpose, a forward motion towards your divine destination. And forward movement comes from making God big in every area of your life. We sing songs, we sing worship about magnifying the Lord. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Magnify and exalt his name. When we're talking about magnifying and exalting God, we're talking about making God big. And anytime your situation becomes bigger than God, it's a problem. I'm not prospering. As long as I'm making God bigger than my situation in everything I do, in everywhere I say, wherever I go, as long as God is bigger than my situation, then I'm going to get to my destination, and that's what the Bible calls prosperity. That's biblical prosperity. So, forward motion. We have to keep God magnified, right? We make God too small. We keep God like he's 2 feet tall on a leash, and give him our laundry list and get mad if he doesn't do things the way we do. That's not how God functions. And I promise you, people tell me stuff they do all the time. I'm like, how did that work for you? Because guess what? You're not God, right? God's not here to glorify you. You're here to glorify God. That's how this thing works. So I want to take you today to one of the parables that Jesus taught. And I want to show you some amazing things out of this well-known parable of Jesus. And it's one of those parables that begin with the phrase, the kingdom of heaven is like. And that one phrase, the kingdom of heaven is like, appears 12 times in the Gospel of Matthew. And I want you to turn to the book of Matthew. 12 times in the Gospel of Matthew, the first book in the New Testament, the Lord says, the kingdom of heaven is like. You can look it up in your Bible software. Concordance is there 12 times. 7 times it's there in chapter 13, and then once in chapters 18, 20, and 22, and 2 times in chapter 25. And we're going to go to the very last time that Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is like. And he says it in this parable in Matthew chapter 25. And first of all, I want to ask you this question. What is the kingdom of heaven? What is the kingdom? We talk about kingdom. What is the kingdom of heaven? And I've heard people teach sometimes, well, this is what the kingdom of God, and this is what the kingdom of heaven is. And can I tell you something, just biblically speaking, the kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven are referring to the same thing. It's just that you see it in different gospels, depending on who the message was written to. Most people in general gospels, epistles, and to the Gentile world, it was written as the kingdom of God. But to the Jews, which Matthew was writing to the Jewish people, you never see him refer to the kingdom of God. He calls it the kingdom of heaven. Why? Because they revered the name of God as holy, and they did not just simply write it out and use it a whole lot. So he referred to the kingdom of God as that aspect that God rules over, and he calls it the kingdom of heaven. And this is important, because the next question I have for you is, where is the kingdom? Where is the kingdom? Jesus said the kingdom's inside of you. Let me tell you where the kingdom is. The kingdom is wherever Jesus is the king. Whatever Jesus has lordship over in your life, wherever he is the king of your life, wherever you're walking in obedience and submission to Jesus, that's the kingdom manifesting your life. So whatever areas of my life are of my decisions and not of Jesus' decisions are not kingdom decisions. And they cannot have kingdom blessing attached to them because Jesus isn't the Lord of them. So what I have to do, the success in my life is determined by how much of the kingdom of heaven is ruling my life. How much of King Jesus is ruling my life. And in those areas, that's where blessing comes. So with that in mind, I want you to look at Matthew chapter 25, and I want to read this parable. We're going to go down to verse 14. And Jesus gives us this illustrative story. He says, "For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them." Notice the word "his." Everything in this story belongs to him. His servants, his goods. "And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. Each according to his own ability." If you underline things in your Bible, I would underline those words, "each according to his own ability." God is never going to call you to reproduce something beyond what you're able to do. He will give to you according to your own ability. "And immediately he went on a journey. Then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more also. But he who had received 1 went and dug into the ground and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. So he who had received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, 'Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I've gained 5 more talents besides them.' And his Lord said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant.'" This parable is where that phrase comes from in the Bible. "Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord." This represents heaven. It represents eternity with God. Verse 22, "He also who had received 2 talents came and said, 'Lord, you delivered me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents besides them.' His Lord said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord.' Then he who had received the 1 talent came and said, 'Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed.'" This is very important, and we're going to come back to this in a little bit. "He said, 'And I was afraid.'" Can I tell you something? Fear-based decisions are never faith-based decisions. You cannot operate in fear and operate in faith at the same time. It can't happen. "I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours." Belongs to God. "But his Lord answered and said to him, 'You wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers. And at my coming, I would have received back my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. Now I want you to listen to this, because this doesn't make sense in our culture a lot. "For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he will have abundance." Why? Because he's a good steward. And if you think that's unfair, listen, God always gives more to productive people. "But from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away." Why? Because of poor stewardship. And here we come to the very sad part of the parable. "And cast the unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." This represents eternal hell, eternity separated from God. Put your hand right on that parable and close your eyes with me. Holy Spirit, I thank you that these words that we're speaking will get past our minds and into our hearts and transform us by the power of your Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, keep in mind that this whole parable is here to symbolize what? The kingdom of heaven. What is the kingdom of heaven like? Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is like this, and then he tells the story. So we know that the story is not just about money investment, but the money investment is an illustration that is used to symbolize something much bigger. When we're talking about God's blessing and prosperity in your life, we already said it. Jadeen said it just a minute ago. It is not just about money. It's about all of your life. It's about every area. There are several layers to this, but one overwhelming observation is that life as servants of the kingdom is to be productive. You are called by God to be productive, fruitful, and growing, because his kingdom is a fruitful, growing kingdom. God's kingdom is a kingdom of increase. Come on, shout increase. His kingdom is a kingdom of increase. If I had one prayer today, it would be for everyone to know God in the way God really is, and they would experience the full life that God has prepared for them, be able to trust him in their relationships, in their lives, in their family, in their physical health, in their spiritual health, in their career, in their finances, that they would see the all-encompassing nature of God for their life. But here's the point. God did not come to curse us. He came to bless us. He did not send his son to die for us to magnify a curse. He came to save. It says it, John 3:17. God did not send his son to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. This is how it works, right? So God wants to bless us. We were already cursed. He sent his son to remove the curse, to remove the effects of the curse, and bring us into a life of relationship and blessing in him. He came to bring us back together with himself. Why? Because he loves us, because he's relational, and because he wants to be in relationship with us. And so many times we hear messages on blessing and we begin to relate it to some kind of physical outward manifestation, and it dumbs God down and we miss the point. We have to understand this is about something much bigger. And what I'm talking about today is that in every part of life, we need to have blessing. In every part of life, you need to be walking in personal prosperity. The thing that has value in you and around you needs to be multiplying and increasing and fruitful. Why? Because that's the nature of the kingdom of God. And that's when you become prosperous. So God brings you into success. But let me tell you something. Success is always on God's terms, not on your terms. And one person asked me recently, well, what about all the rich guys? The rich that don't know God or don't serve God. Why do they get all the money to make their life better and easier? Here's some truth for you. You can go out and buy a bed. You can buy a nice bed, but you can't buy sleep. You can buy a car. You can buy a nice car, but you can't buy peace. You hear me? You can't buy health. If God makes you rich, he'll make you rich with no sorrow. The devil can make you rich and you'll have all the stuff you need and be full of sorrow, full of misery. So God's purpose and success for my life is much deeper and wider than a bank account. You see it all the time. I see people all the time with stuff. They make whole reality shows over people that have a lot of stuff and are dysfunctional and miserable. And we get entertained by their dysfunction and misery. Because, hey, they're worse off than me. You know? Here's the thing. We get all caught up in this world. This is not how God designed us to live. God has a divine purpose for you. And I want you to understand the definition and purpose of a life that the Bible calls a life of prosperity. Why? Because your assumptions become your conclusions. And everybody has a foundation. And good or bad, your foundation is what your life is resting on. And because of this, it is important not to have the wrong assumptions about God. It's important not to have the wrong assumptions that God's okay with things in my life that he might not be okay with. Or that he might not be okay with things in certain areas that are bothering me, but really to him aren't the main issue. You see, God wants you to be fruitful and productive. And activity is not necessarily productivity. Did you hear what I'm saying to you? Activity is not necessarily productivity. I had a couple of days ago, I had a day where I just spent all kinds of energy all day. I went home tired, exhausted, and didn't accomplish anything. Have you ever had one of those days? You feel like you worked hard and you're exhausted and you ended up at the same place you started? Activity is not necessarily productivity. Those are frustrating days, right? They're treadmill days, right? You expend a lot of energy and end up the same place you started, right? That's important to understand because sometimes we think the busier we are, the more successful we are. No, busyness is not success. Are you progressing toward your purpose, toward your destination? And so I'm going to lay the foundation of this with this statement. A life of prosperity, and remember it's a life, not a checkbook, walks on two legs. These are the two legs I'm going to talk about. Number one, stewardship. And number two, generosity. Stewardship and generosity are two legs. If you miss either one of these legs, you're only going to hop. You're not going to be able to walk. You're not going to be able to run. You can't progress toward your destination. So two fundamental truths for God's blessing is this: God can't, not he won't, he can't bless a poor steward. And number two, God can't bless a selfish person. He can't bless a poor steward, and he can't bless a selfish person. So you have to understand these two foundational ideas if you're going to walk in blessing and fruitfulness. Number one, stewardship. Let's talk about this. Stewardship begins when we understand, first of all, everything I have is not mine. It's God's. My job, my family, my wife, my kids, my car, my house, none of that's mine. My paycheck, none of it's mine. It's all his. Everything is his. And the only thing that we possess that's completely ours is our sin. And it's the only thing we did not receive from God. We receive our life from God. We receive our breath from God. We were singing that before this message. Our family, our finances, our health, our abilities, our intelligence, all of this comes from God. And another thing we receive from God is our talents. And it's interesting because I'm going to pull that same word from the parable that we just read. Everyone gets talents from God. Everyone. And before a talent ever referred to ability or skills, it actually represented a sum of money. And by the way, it was a very large sum of money. You need to get this in perspective so you understand when Jesus gave this parable saying there were five talents, two talents, and one talent, you need to understand that these were massive amounts of money. A talent was the largest unit in accounting in Greek currency. In Jesus' day, it was the largest measurable unit, and it represented about 8,000 Roman denarii, or about 6,000 Greek drachma. One denarii or one drachma was basically a day's wages, give or take. In today's economy, one talent would be worth about $400,000 to $500,000. One talent was almost $500,000. Another way to view a talent would be a working lifetime of earnings. That would be another way that they could see a talent for an average person's working lifetime of earnings. Now, value in Jesus' day was also, and currency was connected to weight. Things were connected to weight. So also another way to look at a talent in Jesus' day, a talent of gold would have been equal today to about 75 pounds of gold, would have been actually worth, in today's value of gold, in that weight, it would have been worth over $1 million. So there's a lot of ways that you can look at a talent if we're comparing it to what it is today. But you have to understand, when he gave them five talents, that was an enormous amount to be entrusted with. It was so amazing also, it's so amazing that the word talent in our culture today has come to mean something that we can do well. Our inner value, our special abilities. Every one of you has special abilities given to you by God. Every one of you. You have specific talents, and they carry great value to your personal life and to the people around you. Every person here has something that you can do well. Every person in this room, you have something that you can do better than I can do it or other people can do it. In fact, you are born with talent. But here's the key with talent. You have to develop it. Talent has to be developed. If you don't develop talent, it's waste. But when I develop talent, it becomes something called skill, right? A developed talent is something that we refer to as a skill. So I was talking earlier, I was talking to Awesome for Service. I was looking and I was asking, I said, you know, who do you think is the greatest basketball player of all time? And a lot of people said, I looked online, a lot of people's like Wilt Chamberlain. He's like Wilt Chamberlain. A lot of people are saying, you know, Michael Jordan, and we got some up-and-comings that are trying to vie for that position. But you have to understand that a guy like Michael Jordan was born with a talent, an athletic talent for basketball. But the reason he became rich and famous from the sport is because he worked hard and developed the talent that was in him. I'll give you an example. I can practice as hard, I could exercise as hard as Michael Jordan, I could practice as hard, I could do more than him, and I'll never be as good as him because I don't have that talent. You hear what I'm saying? But no matter how much talent Michael Jordan would have never been as good as he was, or he would have never even been known if he hadn't developed the talent that he had. So why am I bringing this up? Because the development of talent into a skill is a process called stewardship. That's what stewardship is. It's the developmental process of my talent into a skill. So the question of stewardship is, what are you going to do with what God gave you? What are you going to do with what God put inside of you? How hard are you going to work with that talent that you have? How focused are you going to be at developing those things inside of you, those giftings, those talents, those abilities, to the full level that God intends them to be? Why am I saying this? Because that is directly connected to prosperity. A position of blessing in my life has everything to do with my stewardship or how I develop what has been given to me. That is in the parable of the talents. Why? Because God wants to partner with us, because as I develop what he's created in me, he gets glory. As I develop the things and work out the things that God has gifted me with, he gets glorified from it. Because it's him that created it to begin with. It's like the seed that finally emerges into a beautiful tree or a flower. It becomes something glorious that goes back to God. And it's this stewardship that's so important. We have to be faithful. We have to be disciplined with how we work and save and give. It's one of the reasons why I want everybody to tithe. God, it's why I'm talking about God wants to be first. Because when you recognize him first, if you don't bring your best to God, if you're not stewarding your resources here so you can have something over here to bring to God, the Bible says in Malachi, you take on the nature of a thief. And let me tell you about somebody that is prosperous and somebody that's a thief. They both can have material possessions, but the source of their material possessions came from two different places. And the destination of the two different natures are two different destinations. This is really important to understand. You cannot ever be blessed if you're living under a curse. God wants to break that off of you today and bring you to a new place. The second leg, let's get into this, generosity. Generosity is always identified by how we give. It represents the nature of God because God is a giver. God's nature is giving. extravagant. God is extravagant in what he does for us. He's an extravagant giving always brings an extravagant reward. If you turn over one chapter from Matthew 25 over to chapter 26, you see another event that happened in Jesus' life when he went to Bethany at the house of Simon the leper. It says in verse 7, a woman came to him having an alabaster flask of very costly fragrant oil, and she poured it on his head as he sat at the table. But when his disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, "Why this waste? For this fragrant oil might have been sold for much and given to the poor." But when Jesus was aware of it, he said to them, "Why do you trouble the woman? For she is doing a good work for me." You know what she did? She valued Jesus more than she valued her treasure. She valued her blesser more than she valued the blessing. He says, "For you will have the poor with you always, but me you don't have always." He said, "It's important to deal with the poor. It's important for me, but I'm the more urgent matter right now. For in pouring this fragrant oil on my body, she did it for my burial." And look at this, verse 13. "Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will be told as a memorial to her." He said, wherever the gospel is preached, it's going to be connected to the worship that this woman did right here, to the extravagant. The oil was expensive. It says that it was worth 300 denarii. I told you a denarii was a day's wage. So we're talking about a year's worth of wages is what that flask of oil cost. That's some expensive stuff. And she takes the entire vessel and breaks it open and pours it out. It was extravagant. It was extravagant giving. It was an incredible example of generosity because of recognizing the value of what she was doing. I wish every Christian I knew could become prosperous, but that would mean every Christian would have to be a faithful steward, and every Christian would have to be a generous giver. I wish every believer could know what it's like to live in the immense blessing of God, but that would mean every believer would have to know what it's like to be a faithful steward and a generous giver. My desire is to be both vigilant and generous. I want to be vigilant in my budget, and I want to be generous in my giving. This is another way to look at those two legs. The reason I need to become vigilant is so I can be generous. The reason I need to be focused over here on my stewardship is so that when it comes time over here to give, I have something to give. Right? The two are inextricably tied together. You have to learn to give when God tells you, and you have to learn to give how God tells you, by faith and obedience. Not emotion, not manipulation, by faith and obedience. Not fear, by faith and obedience. I know people who are too tight, they're not generous. God can't bless them because God's nature is generous. And when you operate outside of God's nature, you operate outside of God's blessing, and it's not God's fault. I know other people who are extremely generous, but they're also extreme in their spending. God can't bless it because they're not good stewards. Because we have to do what we see in the parable of the talents. And so I gave this example in the first service, and I gave it a few years back, but I was in a hotel in another country where I was with a person that was traveling with me. I was speaking at a conference. The church there was covering my expenses, and they said, "Listen, anything you need, a hotel, whatever, just take it. It's covered. We're going to cover all the expenses." And one of the guys, or the guy that was in the room with me, wanted to grab a Coke, and I said, "Wait a second, because if you've ever stayed in a hotel and you know those little refrigerators, and you know the Coke that you normally pay 75 cents for is like $3, right, in the refrigerator." I'm like, "We're not spending $3 for a Coke." And it wasn't even a big one. It was a little one. I said, "Listen, we're not doing that." And I don't want to. I don't care. But they're covering our expenses. I don't care. I don't want to use $3 on a Coke. So we walked across the street to the store and got six Cokes for $3. Right? It wasn't convenient, but it was better stewardship. And listen, the pastor that was leading the conference heard about this, and this is what he told me. I'll never forget it. He said, I have never seen an American minister who would inconvenience himself that way to save money for us. Wow. So here's what he did. He said, I want to honor you. He said, just because you honored me in that little thing, I want to honor you. And he gave me an extensive more amount on my honorarium when I left. I got blessed. Why? Because I was a good steward. It was a little thing. It wasn't that big of a deal. God wouldn't have been angry if I'd had the Coke out of the refrigerator. I had permission. It was just a mindset of stewardship, and that honors God, and it opens the door for blessing. It opens the door for blessing. So back to the parable of the talents. I saw something in this parable that I hadn't seen before, and I never really understood it till recently, and I want to share it with you. The guy with the one talent that buried it, the Bible says he was cast into outer darkness. And you think, well, that's a harsh punishment for a bad investment. Remember, the story is symbolizing something bigger. It's a parable, right? My question to you is this, with the eternal points that are being revealed in this parable, is it possible that there is something valuable in the nature of your eternal soul? Is there that there's something so valuable on the inside of you that one day when you stand before God, he wants a return on what he invested in you? Is it possible that there's something in you in the nature of God's purposes that God wants to get back? Is it possible that this has to do with eternal value, that it's something much bigger, it's something much deeper than just our natural resources? The guys that increased what the master had given them, we know it was eternal. They said, enter into the joys of the Lord, definitely a representation of heaven. The guy who didn't was cast into outer darkness, definitely a representation of hell. And here's what God showed me. Verse 24 says, he who had received the one talent said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered. And in the verse 26, the Lord answers him, wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. And that bothered me. Have you ever read stuff? Sometimes you study stuff and it just bothers you. Like, I don't really get that. Because what bothered me is the nature of God is not to be hard toward us. Right? God is not a hard man. And besides that, God definitely doesn't reap where he hasn't sown. Everything that exists, God sowed it. It exists because of that. Yet it sounds like the Lord confirms it in verse 26 when he says, you knew that I reap where I haven't sown. So I began to study this out and I went to do some word studies. And I discovered that there are two different words in this passage for the word knew. When the servant says, I knew you were a hard man, it's the Greek word ginosko, which is the word for knowledge, or knowledge that you have learned about something. So if you put it into translation, it would say something like this. Lord, what I know about you or what I have learned about you is that you're a hard man. Right? And the idea is absolutely religious. And it was religious, and that's why Jesus used this terminology. Because what religion teaches about God is that God has a certain nature or hardness about him toward us. That he's out to get you. That he's out to stop the blessing rather than give the blessing. And it's exactly what the Jewish leaders taught in the day of Jesus. And Jesus was making a point by saying, this is not the nature of God. If you have a wrong perspective of God, if you view him differently than he really is, it will cause you to hold back instead of fully trust God. That's exactly what's the problem with the man with the one talent. because of unnecessary fear, because of what he had presumed, because of what he had learned in a religious mindset about God. Let me tell you something. Religious people kill Jesus. They killed him on the cross and they still kill him. They kill the nature of who God is. But when God responds in verse 26, he doesn't use ginosko. He uses a different word, a word that's seldom used in the Greek language and only in the past tense, eido. And it means to have perception of something beforehand, to preconceive something. So if you expand this out, the Lord was saying, even if that was your perception of me, even if that was your incorrect perception of who I was, even if that was the nature you perceived me to have, you still should have responded in some way. You still should have responded. He said, you still should have recognized this was mine. No matter what you think about me, you still should have recognized that this belongs to me and given it back to me with interest. In other words, you should have at least responded to the obvious, that I gave you something of value. Even if you misunderstand me, even if I somehow was misrepresented in your mind, you still need to look at the obvious, that I gave you something of value, that I trusted you with something of value. And here's the sad thing about the whole story. The Lord says, I didn't even get back what should have been mine. He could have kept it in his pocket and had the same thing with less dirt on it. He said, listen, he's like, he entrusted this valuable thing to the servant and got no return. If you put it in terms of the eternal value that the parable's talking about, in essence, he was saying, I gave you your life. I didn't even get your life back with anything. I didn't even get your heart. I didn't even get a thank you. God gave every man value. He put in every single one of you value. He gave you talent. He gave you abilities. And listen, he gave you an eternal soul and a purpose and an identity. There is a reason that you're here. You're not just here to live life, work hard, get old, get sick, and die. That is not your purpose. Your whole world is surrounding purposes from God. And if you are still alive and breathing, it is not too late for you to walk in your purpose. And the reason I say that is because there's people who think, well, I've already passed that. It's sabotaged. I've been disqualified. All of these things that we think on the inside. And you know what? Maybe there's times that we could all look back in our past and think, I should have, could have, would have. If I would have done this differently. And we're living in regrets. But if you live your life looking backwards, you can't move forwards. And then you're not prospering. Because there's no forward movement. You have to be like Paul in Philippians chapter 3, where he said, forgetting those things that are behind, I press forward toward the goal, the high calling in Christ Jesus. That's your value. You've got to press toward. I don't care what didn't happen back here. You still have things ahead that God wants you to develop and see. And there's things that God wants you to do, that he wants you to flourish and be fruitful in areas that you might have never been fruitful in. And you know what? The Bible even says God can redeem the years. It's not too late. It's not too late for you. There is hope for you. There is blessing ahead for you. There's things that you can do, things that you can sow out of your life. It makes all the difference in the world. And with that eternal purpose that he put on you, he desires at least that you invested into the righteousness of Christ, at least give him some worship. At least be fruitful. God did not give you your soul for it to be buried in the earth and the dirt of the world and then handed back to him empty and filthy and fruitless. That's not what God wants. God has a purpose for your life. And a life of blessing begins by the giving of our lives back to God. With development, with fruitfulness, with strength. That's how this thing works together. That's how life works in the eyes of the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is like this, because when I separate myself from God and I believe God's up here looking at me as a hard God from a distance, and I stay separated from God, It does not, I disconnect from the meaning of my life because I'm outside of relationship. He came to die to bring me back into relationship with Him. Why? So I can walk in the purpose of His Spirit, in the purposes of God. And I have to give the most precious and valuable thing back that He entrusted to me, my life and my purpose. And today, I believe that God is resurrecting purpose because I believe He wants to have you blessed. He wants you to be prosperous today. He wants you to be fulfilled. He wants you to be covered and strengthened. He wants you to walk out of this bondage. Some of you have been walking and you feel like you're tethered down with burdens because there's things that you feel like you're carrying that you can't carry, mistakes you've made, places where that you're in the adversity I was talking about earlier. You're walking through stuff that's challenging. It's challenging you. But today, I believe God is going to break those tethers off, and He's going to push you forward. He's going to allow you to move forward towards your destiny. There's lies that the devil has told some of you about your future, that it's hopeless. There's lies that have been said to somebody here. There's lies that you've said about yourself. Well, I'll never do this. I'll never make it. I'll never this or that. Listen, God is taking you somewhere today, and you need to get a hold of this on the inside of you. There's vision and dreams. Some of you have been put on the shelf. I have a word from the Lord today. Take it off the shelf today. Dust it off, because God wants to bring blessing to you through it. He wants to give opportunity to you. Stuff that you've never had before. It is amazing when you understand the nature of God, and when God blesses you, it's so you can know Him. When God saves you, it's so you can know Him. When God gives you opportunities, it's so you can know Him. And when you develop it and you give your life back and the things to serve Him and represent Him and worship Him, it is all bringing glory back to God. That's something called worship. And worship comes out of a prosperous and blessed life. It really does. Just close your eyes with me right now. I believe the Spirit of the Lord is in this room right now, dealing into the deep places of your heart. I believe He's dealing into the deep places of discouragement today. He's dealing into the deep places of walking through things that you feel like your feet are stuck in the mud. God's pulling them out today. There's things that you feel like have held you back. Some of you have, I don't know who this is, but somebody here has you've literally just kind of given up on the inside. And on the outside, you're smiling and you still sing in church, but on the inside, you feel like you're dying. I don't know who that is, but God wants to bring you back to life today. God wants to bring you back to life in this service today. He wants to do something for you that is going to blow you away. Some people, you feel like you've just been held back and chained down. God's going to break the chains. He's going to break the tethers. And as you step into that, you've got to walk on legs called stewardship and generosity. Developing who I am, giving back who I am. Developing who I am, giving back who I am. To get me to the place of purpose that God has for me. Jesus, begin to move on this place right now. Come on, there's some things that you have. There's vision that you have that's ahead of you. God is bringing back into your sights because He created you. There might be things you haven't even ever realized that God's going to begin to show you. This is why you're here. And that life where you're touching one person and nobody even sees can be more meaningful and more powerful than if you were put on a platform in front of 1,000 people. Don't underestimate the value that's in you. Well, Pastor Lynn, I don't know if I have what it takes. God will never ask you to develop something that is not within the context of your ability. It's a secret in the parable of the talents. God wants to partner with you. It's the secret in the parable of the talents. God wants you to be fruitful and productive. It's the secret in the parable of the talents. Today, Jesus. Just stand up together with me if you would for just a moment. if you're here in this room with me right now, and you feel like God is pulling you in this direction, you feel like the hand of the Lord is pulling you back in the center, He's coming back into focus. But first, I want to talk to those of you who you feel like you've been held back. Maybe you've had wrong perspectives of God. Maybe you don't even know if God, like, you know He loves you, but you don't really understand how much He is there for you. If that's you, I want to pray for you. If you're here today and you feel like, I want to get where God wants me to go, but I feel like I'm just being held back. I feel like my feet are in the mud. That was talking to me. I feel like I'm dying on the inside. That was talking to me. If that's you, I want to pray for you right now. If that's you, in fact, if that's you right now, I want you to slip out of your seat and I want you to come meet me right here. We're going to pray for you. I believe the hand of God and the grace of God is coming to break free things in your life. God is coming to give you a breath of fresh air. He's coming to resurrect something on the inside of you. Come on, we're not going to be ashamed. I'm just going to pray for you. Come right now. Now, somebody else here, you've had some things ahead of you that you haven't seen yet. And in this message, God's reminding you of who you are. Take it off the shelf, dust it off, bring it back. Come on, if that's you, I want you to come down right now. We're going to pray that God's going to open the doors for you in that area. Come on, right now. There's some things that you've been promised by God, some things that you feel like, I don't know if you felt forgotten with it or whatever, but it's been put back in front of your face today, and you're believing God that He's going to fulfill His word over you today in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Come on, right now. Oh, Lord, we thank You, God, for what You're doing. Right now, we're going to begin to pray. But before we do, I want everybody that's at your seats, I want you to lift both of your hands up. I did this in the first service. Lift both of your hands high, and everybody at the front. And right now, Lord, I thank You as we reach our hands up to You that Your blessings are coming down. You're surrounding us with blessing, God. You're pouring on us, God, like heavy rain. Lord, let Your blessing and life flow over Your people. Let it flow into our hearts and our lives. Strengthen us, God, with Your grace and Your mercy, Lord. Strengthen us, God, with Your abilities and creativity, God. Lord, let us see something we've never seen. Open the door and bless us right now, God. Let us be people of blessing, walking toward our purpose. In the name of Jesus, amen. Now, if you're at your seat, stretch your hands forward to these that are up here and begin to pray right now. God is getting ready to break tethers off. He's getting ready to reestablish things. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I call on the destiny, the purpose of God right now to fulfill and finish the work that You have started. Come on, right now. Come on. In the name of Jesus, I speak life into the destiny and the giftings and the values that are on the inside. Everything that is held back, pulled back, in Jesus' name, it's broken. We're going to get to the place. Come on, we're going to get to the place. I call on the destiny, the legacy, the mantle in Jesus' name. Come on. What the enemy wanted to try to destroy you with, God's going to use it to destroy him in the name of Jesus right now. I break off all the heaviness. I see life breathing back into you. God's resurrecting things in you right now. Hope where there's been hopelessness in Jesus' name. I call it out of you right now in Jesus' name. I call it out of you right now in Jesus' name. Right now, Holy Spirit. Come on, church.
There is no one like
Just pray with
you.
Me. There's no one
there
like You, God.
Is none
Jesus.
You. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who You are and fill me with Your heart and lead me in Your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like You. There is none beside You.
Open up
my eyes in wonder.
Jesus.
Show me,
God.
Who You are and fill.
Come on, let Him fill you right now. Let Him fill you right now in Jesus' name. Let Him fill you. Jesus. Come on, Lord. We're building on the foundation of Your love, God. Jesus. Come on. reach into you today, God, right now. Holy Spirit, pull us up right now in the name of Jesus into your purpose. I will not be shaken. Come on, He is your foundation today. Lord, upon your love, it's my firm foundation, God, that relationship with you. Make us unshakable, God. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. Jesus, show me, God. Come on, people are getting free today up here in Jesus' name. Getting free, getting set free, brought back to life. Right now, Holy Spirit, I seal the words we've spoken in this place today. Let them resonate deep inside of us, God. And let the transforming power of your nature change us, prosper us, bless us, God, that we would have the greatest week we've ever had. Fill this room with testimonies, God. Fill this house with testimonies, Jesus. And we thank you, God, in advance for what you're doing and what you're about to do in our lives today. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. Amen. God bless you. Don't rush out too quick. Find somebody you don't know and love them. Part of being in the body of Christ is enjoying the relationships and blessings that God has given us with each other. Find somebody, introduce yourself. Amen. Have a great afternoon. And God bless you. If you're Connect leaders, don't forget, get in a Connect group this week. And if you're a Connect leader, don't forget we have a meeting at 5 o'clock. God bless you.
By your Spirit, I